Welcome to the Board of Education meeting. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for county citizens to review on QACTV, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table. During this meeting, we ask that you turn off your cell phones and/or pagers and hold personal conversations and comments outside the meeting room. We will now stand and be led in the Pledge of Allegiance by Board President Jennifer George.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
When we get started, I need a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the agenda as presented. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. First thing on the agenda is the presentations, which will be the technology integration and student security.
So this is a follow-up to a long conversation that we've had around not only our technology integration plan, but I'd like to welcome Mr. Josh Combs and Christina Schindler. That will present kind of twofold from the infrastructure side to the instructional side. So I welcome them both this morning.
Good morning.
I just don't want to hit you in the head with the light.
Oh, yeah, I'm glad. Thank you.
Good morning. So this morning we're going to give you an overview of our digital transformation with some updates. Specifically, we would like to focus on our five-year digital conversion plan. And specifically, we want to call attention to the instructional implications of that plan. As you can see in the picture here, our students have access. It's one-to-world. It's not really just one-to-one, it's one-to-world. So they're utilizing those devices in multiple facets, from the Chromebooks and laptops in the classroom to doing virtual field trips, with community members outside of the classroom, to using assessments and interactive activities in the classroom and using our smart boards. So our four main objectives for today is to talk to you about our devices and what's being utilized in the schools, as well as highlighting the security and privacy issues. We're going to discuss the purposeful use of technology, as well as professional development that our teachers have been receiving.
This is the plan we came up with the county. We're in year three. Mm-hmm. So at this point, everybody from grades 3 to 12 have a device, a one-to-one device. Next year's plan is to go ahead and take a look at different type of devices. Do we want to stick with what we have? Do we want to try something else? You know, go ahead and buy them. The kids, usually we let kids test a bunch of different models out. That's what we did last time with the high schools, and then see which ones fit us the best. And in year five is when we start again with the middle school devices and the high school, the teacher laptops. And we basically continue the same plan. Next year's also when do we need to change how we budget out, and basically what kind of plan do we really need to come up with, how well did it work. This is recommendations on basically what kind of speed do students need in today's environment, especially for one-to-one. Obviously, we have about 7,000-8,000 students, so they want at least 1 gig per 1,000 users. For ISP, we're not quite there yet. To the next one.
Josh, where are we?
That's what I'm going to show you next.
As far as how much speed we have.
Yeah, that's the next one.
This is the recommendation.
That's the recommendation, and this is what...
Depending on the size of the school district.
Yes, this is what the government recommends. And the next slide would be actually what we have versus other schools that are around our numbers. So if you look at Worcester, which is probably closest to our numbers and number of schools, they have about double what our bandwidth. But if you look at the cost, their internet's a lot cheaper. And that's maybe because they have more competition down there, and obviously more competition. County government is working on maybe getting another ISP provider in our county so maybe we can get better pricing. Right now we sit at 400, which is okay for right now. We sit between 3 to 350 what we're currently using, but if we keep going further, we're going to obviously need to buy more.
Why is it so expensive? Oh, look at Tommy.
It's either Atlantic Broadband. Right now we're Network Mainland. We just don't have choices.
Talbot County has one choice, and that's it.
If you go to across the bridge, they got multiple fiber choices, it's just competition just drives the price down.
Pomaco and Worcester, that's interesting.
Look at Kent.
Yeah. They have a lot less devices, too, but.
That's true.
They're on sale.
We have 2,000 students, too.
Yeah.
Two of our high schools, roughly.
Right.
Yeah, that's, yeah, the entire county is our two high schools alone, so.
Exactly.
Yeah, they're right by the county internet.
Kent County.
But they're about to go fiber, so that number's going to change dramatically, so.
Isn't their county's picking that up, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. These are one of the laws that we have to follow, which is COPA, the Children Online Protection Privacy Act. Basically says anybody under age of 13, online providers cannot keep any data on those kids. That has to be erased, it cannot be sold, and those kind of things. They have to have, that's why if you go on Facebook, they ask you if you're age 13 or under, and that is why, in order to be compliant with COPA. So a lot of sites, we look at the Privacy Act and make sure that they meet that. This is the actual devices we use in order for kids to get out. Basically, it'll go from the Chromebook or laptop. It'll hit our filter, internet filter, which will determine what sites they're blocked or unblocked, and it goes to the firewall, then out to the internet, and then part of the internet, of course, is Google Apps, which we also have settings on Google Apps to determine security. So those are the actual three things we use in order to lock things down or make things private or allow things.
Where's the spot where you keep kids off?
I won't go through each box. Yeah, that'd be the top box. Okay. The top box is the internet filter. This is the internet filter. These are basically do things in categories or URLs. So basically, they're basically the same except for elementary. They're allowed education, games, but everybody's allowed our Google Apps and Gmail. Common sites like adult sites, social networking, hacking, weapons, online, that kind of stuff, that's blocked across the board, and they're done by categories. And then teacher, if someone falls into a category that it shouldn't be, teachers will, the principal will know, and we can unblock it in that way. We can have a certain list of allow stuff just for students and make it open in case it falls under a category that doesn't meet the needs of the classroom. The next thing it hits is the firewall, which right now we're using to do mainly QoS, which is basically making certain sites faster than others. So like during testing time, we'll make testing sites priority over everything else. We didn't have that ability last year. So if everybody was doing stuff, and you know, you tell them not to, but if they did, it would kill that out. So we can determine which sites are faster than others. Right now we have the curriculum websites, the main curriculum websites have priority over everything else. So it will slow other things down just to make sure that Discovery Education, Agile Minds work. And it also has a URL filtering, just like our filter. So in case I can't do something with a rocket filtering, I can do it with this box. So it gives me, you know, if I can't do it here, maybe I can do it here. So it gives me more options. This is our email. This is what's done in Google Apps. This is where we restrict what students can do with email. At the elementary level, they ask that only students can email students at their school. Middle school kids cannot email an elementary school kid. A high school kid cannot email an elementary kid. At the middle and high, they can only email people at their level. They can email the middle school, but that's it. They can interact with anybody in the county that has a QACPS.org address. And there are certain sites like we do for password resets. You know, you start giving password resets. But generally, they can talk with anybody in our county or just their building at their level.
So taking that piece from the security and privacy angle and bringing it to the idea of how we're using things instructionally, and the big push that we want to stress to you all today is this is not about the device. It's about access to information and how our students are accessing that information. So if we take it from the top, right now Josh just went through all the different steps of how we make sure that they are getting to appropriate information, but this really is access to that. Then we're talking about how our students are creating information with the digital tools that they have access to. And then finally now we're looking at how they're sharing that information, because no longer do those A-plus scores just go up on our refrigerators, because we have a digital refrigerator where our students can post their work. So that brings us to this graphic, to give you kind of a 20-year timeline of where we have been with web. And you hear it very often, web 2.0 tools, but now we're really at web 3.0 tools. And if you take a second to look at this graphic, and there's a couple things that definitely shoot out. One for me specifically is the idea of user-generated content. So if you think of that in the idea of sharing information, that our students are creating information, and that gets back to the Google Apps, where they're on documents, and they're on slides, and they're in sheets, and they're, so they are not just receiving the information or viewing it, but they're actively creating things. So it's actually pretty interesting from that standpoint, as well as the cloud. You see how that cloud has gotten much larger over the 20 years. And that's what we're using within Google, because our students are able to collaborate within the cloud. So with all the technology in our schools, it is purposefully used. Technology is just not taken out for technology's sake. There's always a purpose for why they're using it. The top left corner, those students are completing a Kahoot within their classroom. So that teacher is using that as a pre-assessment tool to be able to gauge their understanding of content to then inform instruction. The top right corner, a teacher is using a blog space where the students are going in and doing reflections on their reading. In the middle, we have a student utilizing Read2Go, which is allowing her to have access to all her textbooks read out loud. Bottom right, we've got two students, which I love this picture because they've got the high and the low tech going on there. They're working through a math problem in a fifth grade classroom. So they're able to work through it together and partner talk, but they also see their information online on the computer. And the bottom left, we have a teacher who is utilizing a software program called GradeCam to get real-time assessment information on his students so it can also inform his instruction. So again, as you see, all of these reasons the teachers are utilizing the technology is for purposeful uses of instruction. One thing that's really important to bring your attention to is this idea of the digital divide, specifically with passive use and active use. This is a graphic that is from the National Technology Plan, and I think this really drives home the idea of screen time. When we're talking with parents, there's a lot of concern about how our devices are being utilized in school and the time allotment. And I think as a parent, I know when my children come home, a lot of times they are passively watching YouTube video, something like that online, and I think as parents we see that quite often. In the classroom, it really is a flip. They are not passively watching content on the screen. They are actively engaging in all those icons there on the right-hand side, and also as you saw previously in that picture. So I think if you can hold that in your minds, that idea of passive technology use versus active technology use is really critical when we're talking about it in the classroom. And here's a great example of active technology use. We have a fourth grader at Sellersville Elementary School who is utilizing his reading textbook online and also in print copy there. And his teacher has given him a Google form to be able to type his answers in so she can get that feedback. But this is actually another fourth grade teacher's testimony here. So using the technology to individualize content has been very good for her. We are researching Maryland regions and creating Google slideshows. We have assessed using Google Forms, tried Kahoot. We have written and conversed with each student using Google Docs. Today they played a math game on Prodigy that allows me to individualize the content for each of them. So you can see here just by those examples, they are all active uses of technology and the way students are engaging in instruction. Some very innovative ways we've seen technology. This is at Sudlersville Middle School, fifth grade class. I was in there and they were using Finch robots. So I took some pictures of the kids. It was really cool. They were doing some coding with these robots. And the robot is that little white thing in the middle there. And this was in Missy Hollis's room. But the really powerful piece came about half an hour later when one of the developers of the Finch robots actually liked the tweet. Pretty neat real world connection for those students. And let me say how much that empowered them to see the connections of what they're doing in their classroom and how it reaches out into the world and into the community. And that brings us to professional development. At the end of last year in June, we had our third, we're up to surfing the digital wave. We And this year, with our Surfing the Digital Wave conference, it was a one-day conference on June 17th, and it was very successful. We tied in student work this time, so in the top right corner, you see our logo for Catching the Digital Wave, as well as the banner across the top. That was all developed by students within the county in one of their design classes, so that was a nice way to pull in some student work. We also had a lot of support from local community members. We had a whole raffle at the end where everything from a Fitbit up there and Orioles tickets were raffled off to our teachers. They completed some kind of digital badging. We had a bingo card you could see in the bottom right corner there where teachers completed different tasks and they had their bingo cards stamped and then they entered them for those raffles. So it was a really nice way to spark engagement with our teachers as they were increasing their technology skills. And professional development continues ongoing throughout all the schools within the county within their own individual staff meetings and grade level collaborative meetings. So again, we just want to bring you back to this graphic that we started the presentation off with, that our digital transformation is really about accessing information and how our students are able in real time to get the most current information within all the classrooms in our county. And there's Josh and my contact information.
Anybody have any questions?
No? Okay, thank you.
I have a question.
Oh, sorry.
Mr. Combs, could you just explain, so when we buy a product such as Agile Mind, can you just help everybody understand that when we purchase something like that, how we protect student privacy from these publishers or companies from sharing that information?
Yeah, anything that we buy, one of the main things is contracts with them. We have a contract with Google Apps, we have a contract with PowerSchool, a legal contract with Agile Minds, Discovery Education. Even the ones we don't pay for, we still get a contract for. Just for the fact that one of the main important things is what happens with student data. The general rule is we own it. They do not. So if they somehow give it away, it's illegal for them to take it because we own all data with Discovery, with Agile, with Google Apps. So with us having ownership, it prevents them from doing anything they want to do with it. So that's usually the most important thing when we do something is make sure that we have legal binding, we own the data. That way, because we decide, no, we're not going to pay for it anymore. One of the big thing part is either we get a copy of it or it has to be destroyed if we decide not to do something. Because you just don't want to leave it out there for someone else to do what they want with it.
Great. Thank you.
Answer real quickly. So the tweets out,
mm-hmm.
like this thing with Ms. Hollis's fifth grade class, so I'm sure some parents are going to ask, you're allowed to use the photographs, the show.
Students this. All have release.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then this gentleman tweeting back in.
He just liked it.
Gotcha.
He just hearted it.
Okay.
But to have that connection with the developer of Finch Robots to see that he saw his actual product being utilized in your class is really powerful for those students.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, next on the agenda is the P-TECH High School presentation.
So if you remember to a couple of the updates that I had shared with you regarding the governor's release of six P-TECH High Schools. So we wanted to welcome Ms. Thomas today, who's going to provide a very large overview. There's still a lot of details to the P-TECH High School program that have not yet to be determined. Matter of fact, Ms. Thomas and I will be at a meeting next week, so we'll provide more information. But today is more of an overview, so you can ask questions about the concept of P-TECH.
Okay. Good morning.
Morning.
So I just wanted to, Mr. Paluski has given a good overview of just the general information that I'm going to provide, but if, as you've seen in the presentation, there's a couple links there that you can click on after the presentation to check out. There is a Senate bill that you can read that talks a little bit about funding and things, and then there's also the New York model, there's also the Maryland model. So those are some links to give you some extra information about P-TECH as you might have some questions about it. So basically, you're just going to hear a little bit about what's happening this school year, what happened last school year and possibly where we're moving in the future for next school year. So basically, the 2016-2017 model of PTEC for Queen Anne's County and the Eastern Shore is really a planning model right now. We are in partnerships with the three counties, Queen Anne's, Caroline, and Talbot, as well as the partnership with Chesapeake College because they are our community college. So really what PTEC is PTEC is a model that provides students an opportunity to do a 9 through 14 grade. When they graduate high school, they graduate with a high school diploma as well as an AAS degree, which is a middle skills degree. It's not a transfer degree. So that means there are certain degrees that would qualify and certain degrees that don't qualify. They can't be a biology major because that's a transfer degree. They need a four-year degree to get to a job. So things like maybe computer science or IT networking or something like that, those are kind of the models that we would look at. They're really the middle school, our middle skills jobs, and that we're targeting with the PTEC. So they may the job may require an associate's degree or some kind of special training, but it doesn't require a bachelor's degree or advanced degrees. So right now there are 28 million middle skills jobs in America. And by 2018, there's a prediction of an additional 14 million jobs will be needed in those middle skills area. These are opportunities, obviously, for kids that we have in our school systems right now. Most of those fields are going to be in some type of technology or even construction, design management type fields. So PTEC addresses that in a way that it gives the kid the opportunity to have the high school diploma as well as the degree by the time they finish. So that was really Governor Hogan's model when he brought this to Maryland. He did tour New York. He liked the New York model. The New York model just graduated its first cohort of students last May. So there are students who have gone through the whole 6 years of their schooling. In Maryland, the PTEC grants that were offered last year were planning grants. We are in the year of planning. We took the grant last year. We wrote the grant. We received the grant. It was a $100,000 grant, which sounds like tons of money, but not money at all to plan a whole school and open a whole school and get that moving. And it's also shared with three counties as well. So in Maryland, right now, Baltimore City has two PTEC schools. They opened in August. So they are up and running. They do have students in them. They are partnered with Baltimore Community College, City Community College. Their business partners are Johns Hopkins and Kaiser Permanente and IBM. So they have some rather large business partners. Prince George's County will open two PTEC schools possibly next year. They're in their planning stage. Allegheny County and then the Eastern Shore. So the Upper Eastern Shore took the planning grant. The Lower Eastern Shore did not apply. So basically, what that planning grant is for this year is really just to figure out, is this even going to work in our area? Is this something that we can pull off? Is this something that would be good for our community, good for our businesses, good for our community college and our school systems? So right now we are looking at every possible pathway, situation, design of a program that we can use possibly to open a school next year, if that's possible. So as Mr. Paluski said, we're attending a meeting on Monday at Chesapeake College. Chesapeake College has kind of counteroffered a model that is not the PTEC model. So we have to take a look at what they're offering and if that's good for our system or not. Yeah.
Good question.
Sure.
I'm a little confused. You said this is pathway to technology. And you said the computer skills. Now, if they get an AA in the computer skills, isn't that transferable to go toward a bachelor's? Are any of those AA, aren't the AAs transferable?
They are, but these are not transfer degrees, so they're not taking all of the maths and sciences that may be necessary for a University of Maryland. They're taking what's necessary for that particular degree. So they may take statistics instead of college algebra or something like that. But whatever it is, they're not necessarily the pathway to a four-year degree. But a student could certainly take that degree. Once you get an AA degree, you can certainly take those credits and move them into a four-year degree very easily. But they just might have to make up some of the basic credits.
Okay. But like nursing, I mean, you said it was a...
Well, nursing doesn't qualify for PTEC in Maryland.
Oh, it doesn't?
It doesn't, mainly because of the amount of credits that it requires, and then the fact that students have to be a certain age to get to certain pieces in the hospital and things like that. We went through that with the one of the emergency management programs as well. We've kind of looked at all of the programs that Chesapeake offers. We've looked at them under a microscope. We looked at what the PTEC grant and model is requiring from Maryland or in Maryland, and we kind of came up with three different pathways. And again, though, Chesapeake has kind of countered offered at this point. So the three pathways that we had come up with was the School of Business, the School of Applied Technology, and the School of Construction Design Management. Those are also where our workforce data points are coming in and saying these are the needs of the Upper Shore. These are the needs of...
That's the Eastern Shore thing. I'm just wondering why, like, Kaiser Permanente and Johns Hopkins are partnering with one of these other counties, but they can't be nurses. I'm not really sure why.
Well, they're partnering with them through cybersecurity, computer science. They're partnering with them through some of the other health fields like medical transcription, radiology, those kind of things, not nursing.
Okay. All right. I see. Thanks.
Tina, I have a question.
Sure.
Are we, if we're thinking about doing this next year with Queen Anne's, Talbot, and Caroline County, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Are we surveying our eighth grade students and our eighth grade parents to find out if they're even interested in those three counties?
We haven't gotten to that point at all. Right now we are still at the point of we don't have business partners at this point.
I think that would be very important.
It's
to
on
know.
Our timeline. We
yeah.
had to submit, when we submitted the grant, we had to submit a timeline of what we would do and how we would roll this out. We are probably about 6 to 8 months behind on that timeline.
Right.
Opening a school in August next year, in my honest opinion, is probably pretty far reaching at this point. But yeah, that's definitely something that we have to communicate that to the schools, the parents. Do we want this? Businesses are saying this is a good idea, but no business has really stepped up
right.
to say we're
right.
going to take
well,
this
we'll,
and run.
We'll, yeah, we'll donate right. money to it.
Exactly, like
yeah.
IBM did and Johns
right.
Hopkins.
Right.
Yeah.
I just want to add, I think where we are is with the other counties is trying to find out the model first. What is the model going to
okay.
be? And then as we start marketing and start reaching out to students that would be viable to be part of this will be the next step. What's unique about a regional program, as you mentioned about the partnerships in Baltimore City because of their location, in a regional model, we might have to have 7 or maybe 8 different business partners, which makes that unique.
Exactly.
And so, as Tina mentioned, next week when we meet with the other, the superintendents and their career and technology education is to really try to figure out what's the model going to work for us in this regional component. And the other thing I just wanted just to reiterate is that Queen Anne's County will be the fiscal agent for this school. So we're kind of part of the lead, really, that it would kind of live here but pull from the other jurisdictions.
Have we contacted anyone yet to try and be a business partnership with
us? We've contacted Shore Health. They're on board.
What about Johnson Controls?
The one thing about this model that we have to keep in mind is that in the three counties, basically, for one, it has to fit into a program that Chesapeake offers, unless they're willing to design a new program. And the business partnership, the responsibility of the business partnership is to provide mentors through the entire 6 years. It's also to provide a first in line for the job. So when we approached a lot of the businesses, especially the smaller businesses, they said, you know, we're just hoping to be in business in 6 years. We're a small business. So we can't say we're going to provide this person an opportunity to have employment. So Shore Health was on board. We also had one of our county commissioners, Mr. Wilson, was working with a lot of the local, like HVAC, electrical, those type of construction management programs, the companies that were here. And they were very willing to take interns and teach them how to be apprentices and teach them, you know, so that they can get their construction management degree or whatever. But again, that's something that's still in the planning stages because we have to develop another program at Chesapeake in order to make that work. Some of the computer science pieces were, you know, we do have companies on the shore that can help with that, but some of the companies are very small. You know, they're running six people in their business, so, and they're contracting out. We have approached Purdue as far as their business side of it. So because of proximity, that's a little bit difficult because we have to get the students to the jobs to be able to intern. And then we have to get the people who work there to be able to come to us to mentor. So there are still a lot of things that are kind of left hanging and challenges that we have to just work through. That's why it's still a planning year. So basically, just a little bit more background on that. So it's three pieces of the partnership. It's the school systems, it's the business partnerships, and it's the community college partnerships. If any one of those pieces of that three-legged stool doesn't work, then this isn't going to work. So we have to make sure that we have it, you know, pretty set at this point on what we're doing. Students are going to enter PTEC by ninth grade. By 10th grade, they're going to start taking college classes. So one of the things financially wise that we have to consider, you know, once we do this, some of the challenges really are we did receive the $100,000 planning grant, which is all about planning. And that's to hire consultants, that's to hire people to look for, you know, data points, to work through the curriculum we have to lay out, maybe possibly people to do marketing for us. So those are pieces of that grant that where we would be using that money. It also, one of the stipulations of PTEC is that it must be a separate school building or a wing of a building. So when the three counties decided they were going to do this, neither county had the space. They didn't have a wing or a place that they could shut off or whatever it happened to be. So we thought that the best place to house this was at Chesapeake College. They have a couple buildings that are empty, not being used in the way that they would like them to be used. So we thought that would be a great facility to use. Plus, the students are on the college campus. Students, once they join PTEC, they are PTEC. It will have a separate school number. They won't be Ken Island. They won't be Queen Anne's. They won't be Talbot. They will be the Eastern Shore Academy, PTEC Academy students.
Is this going to replace our dual enrollment?
No.
Okay.
It is something like dual enrollment, but it is completely separate from that.
So like dual enrollment, we haven't figured out yet the parameters of the cost for the students.
Well, the PTEC cost is 0% or $0 to the student. So if a student is a PTEC student, the counties have to pick up the cost. The degree is free, the materials are free, everything has transportation. There's a lot of financial issues to think about when we move forward with this.
And where it fits in our budget.
And where it fits in the budget of not just us, but the other counties as well. So that basically, I think that basically just kind of gives us a little bit of an overview. Like we said, we are meeting on Monday to kind of take a look at the proposal that Chesapeake has come back with, which does not fit into the PTEC model, but I think we can kind of work through some of those parameters. There is not a lot of state funding for this, but I do know that the governor is dedicated to it, so he has been putting money into a fund for it. But it's not going to pay 100% for the students to attend to do that. So the school systems are going to have that into their budget. So basically, moving forward, we're still meeting with our stakeholders. We're still meeting with our business partners. We're still moving forward with a plan of study, course of study, you know, whatever we can do to make this work, and how this can work for our county and how it can work for our students. It's a wonderful opportunity for students, especially non-traditional college students or someone who just didn't ever see themselves as going to college and getting a degree.
Be my
and being
question.
Able to pay for it.
When it's all totally up and running, how many students would there be?
So we were looking at about 30 per cohort, so 30 per grade level, and that's pulling from the three counties.
Oh, okay. So actually, 10. If you're doing it, it would be 10 from each county if
yeah.
the other two counties go.
Mm-hmm. Is there a requirement to get in?
No, there can be no enrollment, no registration.
Is there a limit of students we can?
Well, there will be a limit because basically that's going to be determined by the budget. Because at some point, the marginal utility is going to be a little bit higher
Then we would have a set of requirements to get in. Because
there,
if we
there
had.
There can be an application process.
Right.
There cannot be a requirement.
Okay.
And would you be.
So it's been recommended that it would go to a lottery type factor.
I mean, it's part of the logistics. They can only enter in at ninth grade.
They have to enter in at ninth grade.
So if you got this started, a senior couldn't go in.
No.
And to that is Ms. Thomas was saying, because it's a cohort model, that those students will, as they enter, will travel together and be part of their internships together. So it really creates a smaller learning community concept in with a really a middle college model.
Wow.
Thank you. Any other questions?
So again, there's some links if you want to check out some other information about PTEC and how it's been organized and run in other states.
Thank you, Ms. Thomas.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda is the Academic Indicators Report.
So as you recall, at our last work session, Mr. Brown and the CNI team presented on our revised academic indicators. So today, Mr. Brown and the entire CNI team are going to share the results of those indicators and some forecasting of our targets in the near future. Welcome, Mr. Brown.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As Mr. Pukulski said, last month I shared the academic indicators with you. This month, I'm going to provide you with some of the data that will support the academic indicators. So we'll be looking at the PARC scores from the 2015-16 school year. We'll be looking at some of the AP exam scores, as well as the MSA science scores. On the screen now is the PARC 3 to 8 language arts skills. And again, the 3 to 8 scores are based on the PARC assessments that were administered last May. You can see our middle schools did very well. Our elementary schools showed improvement over the previous year, but we're not scoring quite as high as we'd like to see them. If you look at the state ranks, you can see where we are at the middle school level. Our seventh grade students performed at the top of the state. Our
that's
eighth grade students the second
half,
highest.
Right?
I was
kidding. It's only
57%. 57, it's again, we're not talking high scores. And again, when this is level 4 and 5, which is the met or exceeded, we're not looking at that level 3, which is another huge chunk of our students. But again, the PARC test is a new assessment. It is a very rigorous assessment. And I think across the state, school systems are finding it very challenging. Looking at our growth data between the 2 years, and again, it's hard to show trend or growth data with only 2 years worth of data. But if you take a look at that, you can see that our elementary schools, third grade had some slight growth. Fourth and fifth grade are pretty much a flat line there. And the middle schools, we did show some growth in between the 2 years. projecting out towards 2021, which is where our indicators are written towards. This just kind of gives you an idea of where we're going to need to make growth to take us from where we were in the 2015 school year test scores to where we want to be in the 2021 school year. And that would just give us kind of a roadmap as to where we're going to be targeting.
So we're, if I'm looking at this correctly, we're only projecting a 25% growth in 5 years?
That's correct. We're, our target is to be at 75%. So in some cases, it's a faster growth than in other cases. So if you're looking at the fifth grade, it's 25%. It's a little steeper when you start looking at some of the other grade levels that start out a little bit lower.
So this is how we are, these are our targets each year to reach that goal?
Correct. It's basically just a straight linear roadmap.
Mr. Brown, if you want to maybe share with the board, similar to when we transitioned to MSA and HSA, we did some similar kind of forecasting at a similar place.
That's correct, yeah. And each assessment, the statewide assessment, usually the state gives us targets that we want to be at. In PARC, we haven't received any targets from the state, so these are our own generated targets. Again, our indicator says that we're hoping to be at 75% meeting or exceeding in 2021. So we just took where we were starting at and projected it out, you know, dividing it up over the course of the next five assessments.
Dave, I have a question.
Yes, Kevin.
This has been bugging me all along. I haven't really gotten my mind around it. Is we went ahead and started this earlier than a lot of the counties, right? Because we were on the leading edge, trying to make it, you know, jumping in it early in hopes of us having, once the rest of the state comes in, that our kids would be used to it, so we should have better scores. Is that some, am I right on that, or is that some indication why maybe middle school's doing better than elementary?
That could be a part of it because, you know, the middle school's had this curriculum and has been working with this curriculum for longer than the elementary school. It's brand new to the third grade. Hasn't had this assessment as long. Although we have been teaching the content standards for the past 3 years for those students. And they have been getting guidance to it up to third grade.
But not the actual assessment.
So. But no, again, third grade, this is the first year the third grade would have taken this assessment.
So in 5 years, when the third grade will then be eighth graders, we would definitely see the 25% growth, if not more.
Right.
So you're being very conservative on your growth markers.
We are hoping we are being very conservative on our growth markers.
But like the number one and number two in the state indicators, sort of that concept of where we were hoping to be better than the rest of the state because we started it earlier.
Right, and in middle school we are. In middle school, 1, 2, and 4
right,
for the
right.
three grade levels in
so
middle school.
I feel better about that. Originally.
So that might be as a result that we did start earlier, although several other school systems did start with us, and they are also the ones on the top of the charts as well.
That's an explanation to some of the parents then, because I know we started it before, and they're like, why are they doing this? Our scores are bad, right? You know, so we had this bad situation, it seemed, in hopes of being ahead of the curve when everybody else jumped into it. Thank you.
When we look at subgroup data, we have major concerns. Achievement gap. I said that last year when we looked at data, and it holds true again this year. We need to start closing some of these gaps.
You now do a multicultural category?
I include multicultural, multiracial.
I'm sorry, multiracial.
Multiracial. It is a growing population in our county, and it actually has more members than some of the other subgroups that we track.
Do you have data on which ones are multiracial?
Multiracial is any person of two or more races.
Right. I mean, and we have actually identified that on.
Yes, that's one of the requirements we're required to report on for federal data.
Good. Good, because I know they're always confused when they have to say which they are.
So, Mr. Brown, just if you could just help clarify this screen, which represents in our subgroups, this represents the number of students achieving a level of 4 or 5 in that.
In those subgroup areas. So the red bars are all student subgroup. That is every student calculated into it. The blue bar would be the multiracial students and so on across it. There are some places where it is less than 5%. We are not allowed due to FERPA to report numbers less than 5%. And the asterisk means there just wasn't enough students in that category to give any kind of an accurate measurement. And in some cases, you're talking 0 students or 1 or 2 students. And when you're looking at system-wide data, 1 or 2 students in an assessment's really kind of meaningless to look at as far as being able to calculate anything from that data. Switching over to elementary and middle math. Again, you can see we have some higher levels of numbers. It almost switches from what we did in ELA, elementary and middle. Our elementary schools have the higher scores here. Our middle schools tend to have the lower scores in math. One comment there, when we look at eighth grade, is actually divided out separately there, because it can be very misleading when you look at just the eighth grade math score. It looks like we take a huge drop in eighth grade, but also remember that there is an eighth grade algebra group of students there that are tested with a different test than the eighth grade math test. So if I pull those out separately, students taking the eighth grade math test, 31% had a 4 or a 5 on that test. 92% of the students in the eighth grade algebra classes scored a 4 or a 5. So if you look at our total eighth grade population, almost 50% of the students scored a 4 or 5 on the PARC math test.
How many students are in that eighth grade algebra?
About 150 this year.
Out of all the eighth graders?
Out of 550 or so, I guess. We're running about between 22 and 25%.
And that's Algebra 1?
That's Algebra 1, 8th grade, correct.
Are they learning the same Common Core?
It is the high school algebra class.
Right, so it's not, they never do get this new Common
Core. No. So the 8th grade Algebra 1 students have a compacted curriculum in 6th and 7th grade. So we take the elements of 8th grade and compact it into 6th grade math and 7th grade math, so they create the opportunity to be prepared for Algebra 1 as an 8th grader. Essentially, it's a year and a half of content each year in 6th and 7th grade.
So when it says 8th grade algebra, 92.4%, that's only those 150 students?
That's correct. That's correct.
Now, are we offering pre-algebra in 7th grade, or is that what you're talking about, the components?
So essentially, if you want to call it pre-algebra class, we don't have a class called pre-algebra, but it's essentially 8th grade math.
Okay.
So most of the 8th grade math is taught in 8th grade math or to the advanced 7th grade cohort in 7th grade. No longer called pre-algebra, but essentially that's the elements of what a pre-algebra class would be.
Yep. Yeah, okay.
And the other 300 and some odd students are the ones that are at the 49.9%.
No,
30%. They would be at the 30%.
Oh, at the 30%. Yes. Okay, I'm reading at the bottom there. Okay.
Do we know what 2 states are above us in 6th and 7th grade?
What 2 counties?
I
want to say it's Worcester and Howard.
Where the most money is. A lot of money.
Worcester is a very high scoring system.
Been.
Usually they're the ones, if we're number 2, they're usually number 1. And we found that past several years in MSA as well as PARC testing.
And that's contributed to just resources, you think?
I think so.
The other high scoring county is Calvert County. It tends to score very high as well, especially in the science tests.
Right. Interesting.
Looking at the 2-year PARC scores, you can see increases at each grade level. In some cases, some very significant increases in scores. Also notice at each level how that green bar has gotten bigger. The green bar is the level five, so not only are we growing the total fours and fives, but we're also seeing a larger number of students moving into that five, level five area.
What are the differences here?
The lighter shade of green is level four. The darker shade of green is level five.
So we have no level five in eighth grade regular?
Not in the regular eighth grade math.
Correct.
Okay. Correct.
But again, look at the difference between eighth grade math the previous year versus eighth grade math last year. I mean, it almost doubled for students scoring.
And the eighth grade last year was a very large class.
Yes.
Yeah, this year's ninth graders, that's a large class. So what, almost half, I mean, 50% increase. So, of a smaller population.
So, also a connection I'd like to make to this is back to the curriculum audit. If you remember, the scores that our math curriculum received were at the highest level. So that shows us that the alignment of the curriculum and that teachers using that curriculum through the resources and professional development is leading to an indication of progress.
And again, similar to what we did with ELA, we did take a breakdown of targets for math. Again, trying to reach that 75% point. With our starting point being where we were during last year's assessments. This slide represents 3 to 7, grade 8s. Again, it's broken down, 8th grade math, and then 8th grade algebra. You can see 8th grade algebra, we are already well above our 75% point that we said we were shooting for. But again, that is kind of separated out. That's not a real separate grade. We've pulled that out of the data separately just so you can see where our algebra students are in eighth grade. And then all eighth grade, again, from 49.9% up to 75%. But we'll break down that data and continue to look at the growth and target it that way. Once again, subgroups, some large gaps there. When I was looking at this data, I found third grade math very interesting. Our subgroups did much better in third grade math than they did in any of the other grade levels or in both content areas. Not sure what's going on there. It's certainly a group that we need to continue looking at and seeing why we're being successful there or more successful than we are in other grade levels.
I can share some insight to that.
Well, I would love to hear your insight.
We put a tremendous amount of work into first, second grade curriculums over the last 2 years. Lisa Booz is the head of the second grade curriculum writing committee, and her team, this past summer and the summer prior to it, really redesigned how we attack mathematics in second grade. So we think that the models that we're putting in place really support the needs of all kids and provide flexibility to helping kids understand the concepts that they're learning in second grade math, which spill directly into third grade math. So through the course of the years, we'll continue to build those strategies, and hopefully over the course of time, we'll see those same kind of gap reductions in process.
And this is also the first year. I don't know, Mr. Watkins, you want to talk about that. Is the first time that we'll have a grade two, by the end of grade two, indicator that we haven't had in year past.
That's true.
You want to connect that.
Sure. So we have a grade two indicator that is asking for 90% of our students to be proficient on the end of grade two benchmark. Our baseline data from last year is 76% on that test. So we have a little bit of growth to make in a few years to get to the 90% mark. We set a higher standard because we want to put an emphasis on early childhood. We know that the foundational pieces of a child's education really does play a huge factor into how they perform and going forward. In fact, it helps to be a predictor even up through Algebra 1. The closer and better we can help kids understand mathematics, even starting in grade two, the more likely they are to be successful in Algebra 1, which is a huge deal.
And just to note, we also have an ELA grade two, but this year, Dr. Neal, that will be a baseline.
Yes. It'll be the first year for it.
So we'll have that both in ELA. So by the end of the year, we'll be able to share with you that baseline information of grade two, and then that back mapping, as they're both referring to, back into pre-K up to grade two, to be able to shoot towards an indication of how well those students will do going into grade three.
Along with many principals who have used that those indicators as their SLOs, they'll be monitoring that at the school level as well.
If the strategies on the curriculum are this successful in third grade, wouldn't you start using them in the other grades like right away? I mean, this is amazing.
Well, the strategies I'm referring to are math-specific strategies. So as the kids become comfortable and master the strategies we're using, such as open number lines and concrete-based models, they will spill into the next grades. I will tell you, the further you get away from second and third grade, the models get to be more difficult. So those same model strategies are far more difficult to apply in sixth and seventh grade. But we're hoping that, so the main focus of second grade is on addition and subtraction, with a heavy emphasis on subtraction, regrouping, those sorts of things. And typically, those are abstract concepts that kids are not successful in conceptualizing and explaining. So we're hoping that the strategies we put in place build a stronger foundation, so when they're asked to apply an algorithmic process in, say, grade four, they will be far more successful. And that seems like a small leap, but that leap allows the fourth grader to not focus on addition and subtraction anymore. It allows them to focus on the multiplication and division, which is the backbone of what that curriculum is. So as we are reinventing our curriculum, we're adding greater resources in the form of lesson plans, in the form of performance tasks, that are really driving the instruction to the place we think it should be. And that's a rigorous representation of the mathematics.
Are these scores broken down by the schools, each individual school?
Each school has their own individual score, so they can look at their own individual data.
I'd like to see that.
I can share that with you if you'd you want to see all the scores?
Actually, I would. I'd like to see what each school is doing.
Okay, I can share that with the board members. It will be a large PDF file because each test is separate in each content area, so you'll have 12 times each content, each grade level. So
that's fine, because I like, sure. I said, I'd like to see how each school is doing.
Okay, I'll
see if we're doing something at one school that we could be doing at another school to.
I will send that out to all the board members.
Thank you.
Have you been researching that as well? Mm-hmm. Which, what objectives work here, or what's teaching strategies?
Sure. So through our monitoring process, when we're going into schools and looking at how our students are performing and how teachers are teaching the mathematics, we provide adjustments and feedback to the leadership teams and the teacher teams to make sure that we're rolling and implementing the curriculum the way it's intended to implement. And sometimes we identify needs for professional development. So Thursday's professional development, that's tomorrow. We've identified a couple key areas that we're going to attack, even from our early walkthroughs this year, and we're going to address some needs even tomorrow to help our folks be more successful with it.
Okay, Algebra 1 and 2. Our indicator is that we are shooting for 80% of first-time Park Algebra 1 test takers will be designated as on track for meeting college and career readiness by scoring a performance level of 4 or 5 on the Park assessment. 15-16 school year, we were at 55% of our students taking Algebra 1 scored a level 4 or a 5. That was the second highest in the state of Maryland.
How many students was that?
That number includes every ninth grade Algebra 1 kid and all eighth grade Algebra 1 kids. I want to say it was around 600.
Wow.
Howard County was the number one in the state, and we were just a couple points behind them.
600 out of how many students?
In high school?
For the, you said 600 students.
So every student.
For the ninth grade and the eighth, right? The ninth grade and the eighth grade.
So this number basically represents all of our first time Algebra 1 students for last year.
Okay.
And a few kids who retook it from the previous year. It's a very small population of kids. This is every kid who took Algebra 1 last year.
And that could be some sophomores too.
Yeah, a handful of sophomores. I think we were in the less than 60 range of the repeat Algebra 1 students and sophomores last year. So a very large, the vast majority of them were first time Algebra 1 students.
That one good. That's great. I mean, if you're teaching that class, the right strategy for teaching them.
We put a number of things in place last year to see if we could get some growth, and the teachers are doing a fantastic job of teaching Algebra 1, not as a traditional rote algorithmic process, but using it as an authentic process for problem solving. So this year we're actually working on building the procedural fluency in addition to the conceptual understanding so that the kids even do better. So we think that we have a right formula in place to kind of move forward. We also put together a program in place last year called Intensified Algebra. That's a program that we use to target the students that we were fearful that may not be successful the first time through Algebra 1. And we saw a pretty good gain of students in that cohort too. These are the students that get a double block of Algebra 1 each day. So they take Algebra 1 90 minutes all day long. And we purchased a program through Agile Mind that supports the needs of those students, has a learning mindset and a bunch of research-based strategies to help students not only be successful in math, but also get some remediation in middle school math going into the algebraic concept, and to help them understand how they think so they can apply their own thinking while they're struggling through the mathematics. Seems to be very successful. We saw that group of students, we saw that about almost 50% of the kids score a 3 or higher on the PARC last year, and just in that small cohort of students.
These are the math interventions in middle school?
No, so this is a program that we offer to our first-time Algebra 1 students in ninth grade. Okay. But these are identified students that we think could use a little extra support.
The Algebra 2 assessment is probably the toughest assessment in PARC, the most rigorous assessment statewide. It has caused more concern than probably any other assessment that we have. We scored a 30.4% of our students that took the test getting a level 4 or a 5. If you look strictly at the numbers, that puts us number 9th in the state. However, Algebra 2 is not a required PARC assessment for graduation. And we've seen in the scores is that many of the systems do not have every one of their students enrolled in Algebra 2 actually taking the test. So a lot of the systems leading the state in scores are systems that did selective testing of the students. So several school systems that outscored us, we were kind of surprised to see on there until we actually looked at the number of students taking the tests. And we have some school systems that only have 20 or so students testing, you realize they're not testing every student that they have in Algebra 2. So some of the state ranking data is a little bit misleading there. We did show growth between the 2 years, and actually, if we look at
well, what do you attribute there, that to? Is it just money for testing, or are they're just taking a slice out of their?
The primary reason we give the Algebra 2 test. Is
I'm asking about the other counties.
Well,
why? Okay.
The primary reason for giving an Algebra 2 test is we do have to report college and career readiness for students, and the PARC Algebra 2 test is one of the assessments that can be used to report college and career readiness. It has the advantage that it is a free test to give. The other test would be the SAT, AP tests.
Right. Which cost?
ACT and Accuplacer. All those tests are additional fees. So we chose to give the PARC Algebra 2 test and then use the Accuplacer for students that we need to retest or provide other ways of getting college and career readiness for rather than the PARC test. Some school systems use those as a primary test method and only tested a handful of students with PARC that they knew would have no problems passing the PARC test.
So what grade is Algebra 2? Is that ninth grade or is that?
Ninth through 12th.
Ninth through 12th.
We have our first initial cohort is always the second semester of ninth grade year.
Okay.
And then it goes through up through 12th grade. Last year we had just a little over 80% of our students complete an Algebra 2 class, which is a good number, because that's the gateway class into college and a course that most of the college placement tests are based off of. So we have a good chunk of our students having the opportunity to have the class that takes them right to a college placement test.
Are we seeing an increase in college placement AP calculus, the AP and the BC? Have we had a steady growth in that, or has it been flatlined?
I would not say we had a steady increase in enrollment. This year, we've had a spike in equinance. We're working towards realigning our honors program and our regular math program to make sure the kids have the opportunity. But sometimes it's they're choosing other AP courses rather than AP calculus. One of the things that we are going to target is trying to reinvent our AP statistics program. We think that's an opportunity that we're missing for some of our kids.
But these numbers are pretty encouraging that they could be going on to.
We think that the success that they're having on these park assessments, which are rigorous assessments, will help us to see that they could be successful going forward in AP courses as well. We currently, in AP calculus, a good chunk of our students who take the AP class and take the test are successful with a 3 or better on those tests. So we think that this is creating the opportunity for maybe kids to feel more confident to want to go down that pathway. Just remember that unlike some AP courses, AP Calculus has 4 to 6 courses in front of it to get to it because it's the end of the sequence.
Right.
So a student needs to make the commitment to want to take that many math courses. And sometimes there's other things in their schedule that they want to do and doesn't create that opportunity.
Especially taking AB and then BC.
You're exactly right, because that's 3 courses.
Yeah, it's less of a population that will take that.
We still had over 40 kids last year take the BC calc test.
That's encouraging.
You said this Algebra 2 course, passing that is a step toward college for the kids?
That is correct. So it's one of the approved courses for MSD, one of the approved assessments for MSD. If they pass the Park Algebra 2 assessment with a 4 or better, then they are deemed college ready. It's the same thing if they score 500 or higher on the SAT. Or a qualifying score on ACT, or a qualifying score on the Accuplacer. All these tests indicate a student is college ready. So a kid who maybe doesn't pass the Park Algebra 2, the score is a 525 on the SAT, then they're deemed college ready, whether they pass the Park or not. We're hoping that we put enough strategies in place that the students have plenty of opportunities to show us before they graduate that they are in fact college ready. And this would be true for English as well.
Targets, yearly targets for Algebra 1. Again, we're shooting for 80%. We're starting at 55.1%. Straight linear growth gives us our targets for the next 5 years.
Remember, starting this year, the Algebra 1 is a graduation requirement. That students must pass this Park assessment in order to get a diploma. MSD is still we're still waiting for MSD to give us a final approval on what the cut score is for that assessment. Right now, we're assuming it's 4 or better, but it could be in a 3 range after it's all said and done.
And just to clarify that students who take the Algebra 1 test for the first time this year, it's a graduation requirement. It does not affect high school seniors that took Algebra 1 in previous years. It's the year they take that assessment.
So it's actually the ninth graders this year that will be required to pass the Algebra 1 to be able to graduate, correct?
Okay. Eighth graders. And students taking it in eighth grade.
That's correct.
And eighth grade.
Oh, eighth and, right, eighth and ninth. Right. Okay.
Yeah. Anyone who's taken Algebra 1 for the first time this year,
right,
in ninth grade or below,
will be required to,
pass the test. Again, subgroup data for Algebra 1 and 2.
Multiracial group is better than all students.
Yes, in some cases the multiracial group does outscore the all student group.
What is in the multiracial?
Multiracial would be any student that is of more than one race. So it could be Hispanic and black, it could be white and Hispanic, it could be, well, I'm sorry, Hispanic trumps everything. If you're Hispanic, you're Hispanic.
Right.
So it could be a black and white student, a black and American Indian student, a white and Hawaiian from Pacific Islander. So it's any two of the federal racial groups.
And we're getting that off of their enrollment?
When they enroll, they
parents
tell us
select.
What racial groups.
Parents
okay.
select.
Okay.
What'd you say?
Parents select.
Select.
And it may change throughout their high school or their education.
So I find that interesting. So when the children, when parents sign them in, put them in school, there's actually a section that says multiracial?
Actually, they choose all that apply in race.
Oh, okay, okay.
So it, okay. And if they choose more than one, then they're multiracial.
Well, I'm confused then. How do you know? How do you know
if
what the race is and what the two races are? If
I am primarily white, but if my great grandfather was American Indian, mm-hmm. I could choose American Indian and white.
So you would mark both of those off.
I would mark
okay,
both of those
that's
off.
That's what I'm trying
I would be
to.
Multiracial.
Okay. Okay. And now I understand. I was trying to how we know that. Okay.
So Hispanic doesn't fit into that?
Hispanic, if you are Hispanic, you are Hispanic. You're not multiracial. Okay. If you are Hispanic and white, you're still Hispanic, according to federal guidelines.
Okay.
Interesting federal laws. It all has to do with reporting methods. English 10 and 11. English 10, our scores this year were 45.9%. We scored 4 or 5. That puts us right at mid-range of the state. English 11, this was the first assessment for English 11. They did not administer the English 11 prior to the 15-16 school year, at least not in Maryland. And we came out with a 52.8%. On that test, which ranked us as fourth in the state. Growth on those, English 10, slight growth between the two, and of course we can't show any growth on English 11 because it was the first time we participated in that test. Again, English 10 is a graduation requirement. English 11 is used as a college and career readiness indicator, similar to the way that Algebra 2 is used.
Is that those two classes? Those two courses are required.
Yes.
Yeah. Graduation requirement.
That's 4 years.
Correct. I mean, English 11 is required. They have to take the English 11
course, not the assessment.
Right. The course. Yeah. Okay.
Targets for English 10, again, we are shooting for 80% in 2021 and starting at 41%, so we do have some growth to make there over the next 5 years. Subgroup data again, achievement gap. We have some areas to close there as well. Switching over to advanced placement tests. Ms. Harper asked a little bit about advanced placement. We did get our advanced placement tests back. Last year, participation in advanced placement tests, we had a total of 896 exams taken by 540 students. That is the highest number of student participation that we've had ever in Queen Anne's County, and the most exams given in Queen Anne's County.
That just 11th and 12th grade?
In most cases. There are some 10th graders who may take an AP exam, but it's...
Is it only 11th and 12th graders out of that 540?
I would have to go back and look at the numbers.
That's not a big deal. I was just wondering.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I don't remember if any 10th graders participated last year or not.
They can take the test even if they haven't had the class.
They can take the test if they haven't had the class. And that does happen occasionally, but it's a little more rare. We see that in English where they may take one of the AP English courses, but take both of the two AP English tests that are given. There's
are they
literature.
Required to take the test if they take the course?
No, they can take the course without taking the test. We do encourage them to take the test.
Right, you don't get the weighted grade if you don't take the test.
You don't get the what?
Weighted grade. If you don't take the test.
And it doesn't apply towards your college credits either, unless you take the test.
Okay, I was just wondering why that was so amazing that we had them take the test. That's what I was wondering. Required to take the test.
Yeah, it is not a requirement to take the test. We highly encourage them. We encourage them through having the weighted grade.
Okay.
And of course, if they take the test and they score a 3 or better on the test, then they may qualify for college credit for that course, depending upon whatever college they go to, if that will accept the AP courses for credits. Again, last year, more students taking more tests than ever before. If we look at the percentage of students scoring 3 or better, we did have dropped slightly over the previous couple of years as far as percentage of 3s or better. However, if you look at the numbers of 3 or better, especially if you look at the chart on the right side of the screen there, we had 561 exams taken last year with a score of 3 or better. That's almost 100 more, that's at least 50 more than we had last year, or 60 more than we had last year. So we are talking about a greater number of students that may qualify for that college credit than we've ever had before. Again, looking at subgroups and AP courses, especially some of the subgroups here, if you look at the African American population, the multiracial, the Hispanic, and the economically disadvantaged, if you compare the participation in AP courses to the enrollment in the schools, it's about half of what we think we should see. So we're not getting participation from some of the subgroups. But if you look at the scoring in that column, there's not a great difference in the scores from the all student group, which to me translates that if we can get the kids in the seats in those AP courses and we can get them to take the test, they got a strong chance of getting that 3 or better.
So the economically disadvantaged is a slice of all the subgroups.
That's all. That would be any student who's economically disadvantaged.
No, where? I mean, is that farms?
That's our farms kids.
Okay.
So it dropped from 21.8 to 10.8?
The percentage of the school enrollment for farms, farm students represent 21% of our students
right. In
school, but they're only 10% of the students
taking
the AP.
What can we do to get that up?
That's one of the things we're looking into.
Yeah, but 61% of them all got 3 or better.
And 61% of them got 3 or better, which, you know,
at
our all-student group, it's 62%. So if they're getting in those seats, they're doing well. We got to get them in those seats.
We have to get them in those seats.
It's one of the goals of our multicultural committee because it was a finding as well. So we have to look at increasing those numbers in AP classes and GT.
We'll actually be doing a presentation on that, I believe, in the coming months around our multicultural work, but it really gets to this work around the achievement gap and some of the strategies that we can implement in order to deepen or close that gap even faster.
Switching tests, we're jumping into the MSA science test. We received these scores back. This is the last time I will be sharing MSA science data with you. This is the last assessment of MSA science. This year we will be giving the new MESA test, the Maryland Integrated Science Assessment. So for the last year, our students, you can see where we scored at for advanced and proficient for fifth grade and eighth grade. Again, we scored very high, you know, much higher than the Maryland averages. Our achievement gap, still there. And if you look over the trends over the past 4 years, we have not done much to close those gaps. If anything, in some of the areas, they have widened even further. When we look at our MSA science data in numbers and look at comparisons, our fifth grade MSA science scores, we were third in the state, again behind Calvert, which is always up there, especially for MSA science, Allegheny, and then Queen Anne's. In eighth grade science, we were number one in the state at 84.5%. And looking at the data, you cannot deny that great things are happening in Queen Anne's County Public Schools.
I didn't know if any other questions, but I just wanted to give an opportunity to Dr. O'Neill, if there's anything that you wanted to share, and Ms. Hoban, if you wanted to share from your perspective of the work that you're doing in your content areas as it relates to the data.
This year, we gave each of the grade levels to look at the year at a glance with standards, so that way they kind of can focus on particular standards at each trimester. So, and hoping that will ensure that all of those standards are taught, because in reading language arts and writing, there are over 30 standards that have to be addressed by the time we take PARC. We also have realigned our assessments. They're more rigorous, but we're using them more as a formative assessment so that teachers every 6 weeks can give one, and it'll help drive their instruction. And then this summer, we'll be working more based off of what we learned from the curriculum audit on realigning and doing some more work with our curriculum.
Great. Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oh, Mr. Combs, can I have a question on my computer since you're here? Every time I go on the board docs, it like does the whole like. Doesn't that mean it's like a not secured site or something? And it was like that like last week too.
No, that's not. Yeah, that's the your browser updated. The certificate is saying that it's not as secure as it could be.
Oh, okay.
It's more on board.
So it's still good.
Yes, yeah, still good. Okay. It's just that you know it could be more secure if we're not doing their stuff.
Okay. Thank you. All right, at this time, I need a motion to move to closed session.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Why are we
aye.
Going aye. Into closed session? We
have to. Oh, I'm sorry. It. I'm sorry. Yes, you have the second.
Oh, okay.
To read that.
Okay.
My fault.
Neil?
Yeah, please. Go ahead.
Okay. As permitted by the Section 3-305B of the General Provisions Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session to discuss the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluation of appointees, employees, or officials over whom this public body has jurisdiction, or any other personnel matter that affects one or more specific individuals.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you. So, okay, welcome back. At this time, I need a motion to accept the HR report as presented in closed session.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the HR report as presented in closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. And also, I need a motion to close open session.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to close open session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you very much.